Okay. Hi, this is Tintin He.
And this is Amber Liu.
We're here today on April 15th, 2017, in Glenda Joe's house to interview her for the Houston Asian American Archive Oral History Project. Okay, so to start off with, just like tell us about yourself, just the basic biographical information.
I was born in Houston, Texas. I had a Chinese dad, an Irish mom. I don't know what else to tell you. I mean, I'm native Houstonian. I did not like being involved with the Chinese community because they were racist against my mother because we were half-breed children. Mm-hmm. And in the 1950s, it was illegal in 17 states for my father and mother to marry. Anti-miscegenation laws.
Yeah. Was it in Texas?
Not that we found out. I think it was in Louisiana, Alabama, Mississippi. My mom was from Mississippi. But regardless, we're here to talk about the file of Houston Asian American Festival. Mm-hmm. Once upon a time, in Houston, Texas, a bunch of old Asian guys found out that then President Jimmy Carter was going to, for the first time ever, proclaim Asian Pacific American Heritage Week. Not month, week.
Wait, which old Asian guys?
Well, I'll get to that.
Okay.
I mean, this is a story, Tintin.
Okay. All
right. The old guys were Chinese, Japanese, Indian, Korean, Cambodian. I mean, it was weird. I don't think they'd ever spoken to each other, even known each other before. I believe that there's a Chinese man named William Derbing and his wife, Eleanor. I believe y'all have him on your oral histories. Eleanor Derbing.
I've heard the name.
I think you got her in your files. Anyway, they were a real social couple and very couple about town. And they brought in my Uncle Bill Joe. And then my Uncle Bill Joe knew other Asians because he had a commercial license brokerage. So he would run into other Asians who happened to be in business who referred him to other. I mean, the fact that they all got together in 1980 is remarkable. Because you know how all the Asians hate each other. They do. I mean, think about it. How do the Chinese look at the Japanese? They call them yellow monkeys. I mean, for goodness sakes, right? They look at Korea like the slave class of Asia. You know, I mean, for Houston, who never had a Pan-Asian identity and barely had a Chinese-American identity, to bring these people together was nothing short of amazing. It was a miracle. So
Did you say what year that was?
1980. Oh. It was the year Jimmy Carter proclaimed the first Asian Pacific American Heritage Week. Mm-hmm. Not month. Week.
can you tell us, do you know which week it was?
It was in May. It was the worst week in the world for Houston. Because if we were going to have a heritage week, month, it shouldn't be when, you know, you're going to get encephalitis from mosquito bites. All right? I mean, it shouldn't be so hot you can't be outside or so humid or in hurricane season, you know? But it worked in other parts of the country, but that's that's when it was. Bill Joe, Eleanor Derving, Bill Derving, Dulal Datta, the Indian guy, who I wonder what happened to, because he was such a fine gentleman. C.Y. Kim, our Korean folk, Dr. Daniel Watanabe, which is where I first met Dr. Watanabe, and his wife, Akiko. There was a person, I think, from the refugee community. I don't think it was Yanni Rose Kao, who you also have done her oral history, I believe, Cambodian leader. Anyway, so they all got together and they had a meeting and they figured out they didn't know what the hell they were doing. They wanted to do something, but none of them knew what to do or how to do it. They thought they should have an event. Well, they were not people who had ever done an event. So my uncle gives me a call and he goes, I need you to come to this meeting. And I go, I don't want to do this because I'm busy saving the world on women's issues over here, right? That was during when the Equal Rights Amendment was going on, and I was running a Equal Rights Amendment campaign at U of H. So anyway, my uncle calls me, and I go, and I sit, and I listen, and I watch, and it's clear that these people have the best intentions, but they don't know what the hell they're doing, right? Now, my background was theater, and I had done events in my activism.
You majored in theater?
No. Who majors in theater?
I don't know.
It's like someone who majors in art.
Yeah,
oh my God.
They're people.
They're good people. They're going to end up in art. They're going to end up in communications or something. I majored in anthropology. So I understand the cultures, right? I started in psychology, but I found it too Western based. You know, there's not a word for depression in Khmer. Mm-hmm. You depressed? I mean, get over it, right? I mean, that's, you only have the luxury of being depressed if you're an American, all right? Other people, they just, you know, get over it. So, I go to these meetings and I say, okay, I want to help you guys do this event. This one event, right? It's a one-day deal. And they get a bunch of volunteers together because Lord knows I don't know any of these people. I don't want to be around these people. I have nothing in common with these people. And I just have very little... I don't have enough to do on the other side, so I'm doing this. So we do it at Westbury Square, now defunct, but it used to be a pretty hot place. You know, people would show up to buy scented candles and go to witchcraft stores and, you know, eat ice cream. I mean, it was a neat little place back in the 70s. So we did it there. Mel Chen, big artist, right? Designed our first poster. It was a Year of a Tiger. He did, y'all's here. He did a tiger deal. If you go back, you should make copies of that tiger poster.
Yeah.
Okay, and frame it and put it in your offices, okay? Because Mel Chen, his artistry was beautiful, and it was, I think there's only one copy of it left in the archive,
oh,
okay?
Wow.
So it's the first one that you'll come across when it comes to the presentation. So he makes this great poster, and I had never worked with a group of people like that before, and I had never worked in a way that I had to ask people to do stuff for me. So there's one guy, one Chinese guy, who was going to put out the posters, right? And they said, oh, he'll take care of it, he'll take care of it. The day of the event, he still had the posters in his trunk. Lesson one. Don't trust anyone to do what they're going to say they're going to do unless you follow up to make sure they did it. Rule number one. So I had the tables and chairs and all that kind of stuff delivered, little tents, and all these Asian guys were standing around. And back then, I was young and strong, and I had also worked construction, right? So, upper body strength. And I was carrying around those tables by myself. And those Asian guys were just leaning against the wall watching me like I was some kind of Mexican maid, all right? Because why? They did not think, they think they're above doing this work. Very Asian. Also.
So they were all immigrants, in their.
Oh yeah. I was the only American born person there. Right? I mean, my uncle couldn't get any of his kids to do it, so he had to come to my dad's family and ask me to do it. So that's how we did the first one. That's how I met Yanni Keo. Yanni Rose Keo, the Mother Teresa of the refugee community in Houston, Texas for 20 years. And I met her by getting pissed off at her. I thought they were taking, we had tickets for all the booths, you gotta buy tickets to get stuff, And I saw her doing something that made me question whether or not she was taking tickets. And so I jumped her, which at 27 years old, why not? Because you know everything at 27, right? I mean, and she responded to me in such a kind, patient, loving way. She was my first introduction to Buddhism, right? Which is probably why I ended up years later becoming a Buddhist, right? And that's how she became my friend. So we did the event. We had 1,000 people show up, even when the asshole didn't put out the damn posters, right?
So were the people who showed up mostly Asian themselves?
Or no. It was a big mix of people. Mm-hmm. It was like a curiosity, a novelty, right?
Mm-hmm.
So we were pretty successful. And so the next year, the same group of guys got together. And they asked me to come back to help them do it. And I could sense what they were doing is they were trying to dump this crap in my lap, right? That, Glenda, you're the only one who knows how to do this. We'll be here to help you. But, and that's how I became the producer of the event. So the next year we did the event at Sharpstown Center. And we charged admission. We made $15,000 at $1 admission. We had 15,000 Asians show up at Sharpstown Center. That's how I started thinking, well, hell, there really is an audience for this.
Yeah.
I didn't know enough back then to understand that I was really going to have to work at raising money to do the event. So we did it there a second year, and it was successful. The next year, we went to Pondy Recreational Center, which was closer to downtown. And when we did Pondy Recreational Center, Jack Campbell, who was the director of the Miller Theater at the time, approached me and asked us to bring our show, our Asian festival, to Miller Theater. And he said there'd be a grant. I'm thinking, okay. You know? Because raising the money to do this is really hard, and it's not something that I had ever done before. So, 2005, we moved to Miller Theater. And from 1985 to 2006, we were the primary Asian, pan-Asian cultural event there. And they changed leadership in at Miller Theater in about 2005, 2006, and brought in people from New York. And they were gay. Okay. Believe me. I don't think it has anything with them being gay. I think it's more that they're from New York. But I don't know. They try. You have an entire file on Miller Theater.
Yes.
Where they targeted the Asian Festival to do something different with us that they weren't doing with anyone else. Unequal treatment. Trying to take us out because they thought we were a bunch of dumb Asians. Dumb Asians.
And they said, like, it's not professional quality or something.
Well, it wasn't supposed to be. Yeah. We had the entire day. In the daytime, we did children's programming. And then at night, we did professional programming. That had been our deal with them for 20 years. But because the new people came in and they didn't know what they didn't know, and they had targeted, they figured, you know, there was lots of other minority groups they wanted to push out, but they couldn't do it all at once. So what they did, they thought, well, let's go after the Asians. It'll be the easy one first. Right? And basically, you know, they pulled apart our people. They went to our evening professional program and tried to make separate deals with the dance company, you know, the Asia Dance Company. The taiko drum people. I mean, they made individual deals where they ended up spending more money on their grants in order to show that, oh yeah, we can do Asian stuff. The thing that, and it was all over the newspapers, and it was hard because for someone in a position of power to say what we did was unprofessional and that I was not handling the budget correctly, that I was misusing the budget, was, you know, heartbreaking. And the one thing that the reporters who reported on it didn't believe their bullshit from Miller. Brown Foundation and the Strake Foundation were pissed off that those people at Miller would do that to one of their grantees.
It seems like so much effort for, like,
not much.
Yeah.
Well, but here's the thing. Here's the thing that's weird about it. That's just the internal part. Let's look at the external part. In 1980, white folks, black folks, Latino folks, they didn't know crap about Asians. You know, if they were black folks and lived in, you know, one of the wards, they knew their Chinese grocer. That's all they knew. We're talking about 70s, in the 70s, right? And early 80s. In early, between, you know, 78 and on, we started getting this rush of Vietnamese. So, okay, think about it. I'm an anthropologist, right? And one of the reasons why I took this on is because it became a sociology lab test for me. They were all my lab rats. The market, the communities, you know, the public officials. I've got this clean slate, because if you look in California, in New York, in Washington State, all of those Asian communities had become entrenched. Chinatown's Chinatown, Koreatown's Koreatown. You got the Japan Festival, you got your Chinese New Year, you got your Tet. I mean, it was all segregated by ethnicity. I had a chance in 1980 to put in place a Pan-Asian engine. And that is why we ended up not having the kind of stress between groups that you see in other places. That is why we have Pan-Asian support for elected officials. That is why we have Pan-Asian support when we go to the police to talk about what we need to do to help our community across that Pan-Asian identity. That was me. That's on me. And that's because I was a sociology, anthropology freak out, you know, and I saw this as a great lab experiment. And it worked. It didn't make me a lot of money, but, you know, we kept people from getting killed, for goodness sakes. So we left Miller Theater. 2006. And we made a big ass stink about it with the city, right? And everybody knew that they got to do something to keep Glenda Joe shut up. Give her something. Okay, now you have to wait for the next chapter because I'm going to walk around.
All right.
It's a good place to stop.
Yeah. Very, very exciting. What's going to happen?
I know. It's like listening to the radio. Oh, goodness. I'm going to go outside and smoke a cigarette.
Okay. Should we pause it for a second?
Yeah.
Ranch. And when we go to the ranch, you get to run the pasture she lives at. Chase cows and stuff. Tell her to sit. So she'd go and wait by the door just because I said that. And so I figured I'm not going to tell her anymore, you know. But if I just think it, she'll go sit by the door. Okay, play later. Go away. Go away. Play later. Play later. Go away. Go away. That's a good dog. The go away. The go away thing. Okay, so chapter 2. I think it was the guy before Parker, or in between, Bill White. It was Bill White's administration was the one who okayed our slaughter at Miller Theater. I think at that point, because I had filed for public information requests and I had found damning emails from his staff with the Miller Theater people that showed collusion of getting rid of Glenda Joe. Because they knew they'd fucked up. They knew it. And they were trying to figure out a way to avoid me maybe suing them. I mean, think about it, as poor little Asians being run over by this machine of political intrigue. So I went to special events in the mayor's office And I said, y'all got to figure something out. And they said, okay, we'll give you the city hall. Okay, we're going to give you city hall. And we're going to give you a grant if you just shut up. I said, okay, fine. So we did our show there a couple of years, 2006, 2007, because I was already thinking, this isn't going to work. Because here's the problem. All of our Asian community, and this was the same problem we were beginning to see at Miller Theater, even though at Miller Theater, we brought in so many white people who were curious about what is this, all this Asian thing. And part of our mission and our I appreciate not being part of the technological society. I would have had a heart attack about that. Anyway, part of our mission, all of our mission was preserve, protect, promote authentic Asian art from the heart of the cultures. Whether it's little kids doing farm dances or big taiko drums. You know, it didn't matter because it was giving every culture a chance to share their cultural arts heritage with their children to build a remembrance of that culture. Because when my family came, it was kind of like what I heard from you ladies. We want to be Americans, right? When my dad was growing up and then the war came, we had to put signs outside our grocery store saying we are not Japanese. Okay?
World War
II. Yeah. So the thing is that I didn't grow up with learning fan dances or any of that kind of stuff. And I'm very Americanized, as you can tell, right? But watching these cultures struggle to hold on to those things that made them unique spoke to my heart as an anthropologist, right? And it's cultural anthropology. That's all it is. It's just plain and simple cultural anthropology.
So it wasn't so much of a personal thing where you're like, oh, I'm Chinese, so I want to help.
No, because I have never felt Chinese in that milieu. I'm Chinese to myself in my personal life. But because I was never accepted as Chinese growing up, I never saw myself as Chinese. And here's the other thing. The fact that I didn't see myself as part of some tribe made me more accessible to people who said, we have this art form. And I'm looking at it, I'm thinking, this is really weird, okay? But, you know, I'm not looking down on it. If I was only thinking Chinese, I would think it was of no value because Chinese are big on other cultures having no value. I want to make a note here for the recording that my interviewers are nodding and grinning broadly. Okay, so you know the deal. And this is the thing the outsiders don't know. They don't understand how ethnocentric we all right? And it's not, you know, the ethnocentrism that Americans have is nothing compared to the Chinese. They go back for 5,000 years. I mean,
we're about that all the time. Right. We're the oldest culture.
I mean, you know, we're the longest existing culture and get over it, and we're going to win eventually no matter what. I mean, that's a Chinese way of looking at it. And the rest of you guys are a bunch of not as highly evolved people. So, you know, I discounted that view of the world early on. which made the Vietnamese and the Chinese immigrants and the Filipinos and the Indians and the Cambodians and the Laos and whoever else found me a welcoming person for their art. Because my background was art for theater and music and dance and visual arts. I had that background, and because of the basic arts background, I was able to be more open to other art forms. So one of the things when Miller Theater was trashing our show is we did an entire night of the finest martial arts groups in Texas. We called it Awesome Martial Arts. I love that. Awesome Martial Arts. Rolls off the tongue. And the guy at he's not there now. I wonder why. Their executive director at Miller Theater goes, martial arts is not art. Duh. Look at how many billions of dollars they've made on Jackie Chan, you know, or all those enchanted Chinese mythology movies. I mean, where people are flying. I mean, excuse me. But when he said that, he showed he was a New Yorker. He said it in the paper. All the martial arts guys.
But doesn't New York have like a bigger Chinese population than we do?
Not like us. You don't see the Chinese. You don't see a Chinese American like me in New York that pushes back. You know why? Because I'm not all Chinese. Mm-hmm. If I was all Chinese, maybe I wouldn't push back. Right? Maybe being half and half gave me the perspective to think I can push back.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And that there's no one else pushing back. So maybe I need to be the one to push back. I mean, you didn't see Martha Wong pushing back on anything, right? You know? When you do the Martha Wong file, I'm going to be happy to tell you more.
Oh, I have... We finished, like, all everything.
I can see we're going to be doing these interviews for probably the rest of the year.
Well, it's only one, right?
Well, no, I'm only doing one file here. I'm only doing the Asian Festival here.
Oh. I think, well, we would want to hear about, like, your old, like,
no,
life.
No, I can't do that because it's too much.
Okay.
We would be here for 24 hours. And I can't stand having people in my house that long.
Okay.
I believe this. I believe that my life can, and it's not necessarily my life that's of interest, it is what I've accomplished. And in every box of what's been sent, there's another story. There's another once upon a time story. All you're getting here today is Asian Festival.
Okay.
Because it's hard for me to talk about this stuff. It wears me out.
Mm-hmm.
It's kind of like people get married and they want their wife or husband to go, how was your day, honey? I don't want anyone to ask me how my day was. It was bad enough going through it. All right? So doing what I'm doing with you here today is a real exhausting thing for me. And it's only on one box of stuff.
Right.
There's the time you spent here just on Asian Festival, you've been here for an hour and 10 minutes on it. There are 12 other boxes of stuff. So you can't expect to grab it all at one time. Yeah. And I couldn't do it. So is that all right?
Yeah, that makes sense.
Okay. I mean, you may be graduated and raising kids by the time we get finished with this. You know, well, here's the deal, is that you got to be thinking also about handing this over. All right? Orienting the next year's students. Because I don't think there's any way that y'all are going to grab everything that aligns with the information for all of those archives. Yeah. Am I wrong?
You mean like within 4 years of us working there?
Are you going to be there 4 years?
I don't know. It's,
yeah.
Hopefully as long as I can for me.
So, are y'all freshmen?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Oh, God. Okay, then. We're going to be very close friends by the end of this. Okay, so we're back to doing the show at City Hall. Mm-hmm. And what we learned is something that was beginning to happen already at Miller, is that our Asian community had pushed so far out the Southwest that they were kind of like in their own little nests, you know, and they didn't have to venture out of this safe zone in the Southwest where they could buy their groceries, go to their temple, go to their church, talk to their CPA, their immigration. I mean, it was all right there in their Southwest little nest. And I would venture to say 85% of all the Asians who live in Southwest have never even seen downtown Houston. I wouldn't go if I didn't have to, all right? But the idea that they will come, drive all the way downtown, figure out where to park, pay for parking, not good. Asians don't like to pay for parking, okay? Then have grandma in tow and have to walk and find where you're going, and with the kids going nuts, no. So it was in this time frame, 2007, 2008, that I'm thinking, I've got to reconceptualize this event. We gotta take the mountain to Muhammad, right? We ought to take our event to where our community is. I mean, we did our bit in terms of our mission, informing appreciation of Asian culture to the white community, basically, general market. Now we've got to preserve those art forms, all right? And how better to preserve it than to take it back to our neighborhoods? So, I drove around Southwest Houston, and I looked around, and I found Viet Hoa Center. And I looked at it, and there was a lot of open space in it that wasn't rented out, and, you know, they had a lot of parking lot, and, you know, it was fairly easy to get to, and so I made a cold call to Vikan's suntan. Vikan's suntan is the oldest son of the Sun family that came here in, I think, 82 with, I started a little store around Milam. Then they moved that little store to a bigger store on Beechnut. And they parlayed that into knowing the right bankers to build a mammoth freeway block, big retail center.
And that's Viet Hoa?
Yeah.
Oh my god.
I know.
That's so cool.
I know.
Have you been there?
No.
Oh man, you gotta go. Okay, we'll meet there sometime. And you gotta go. I mean, they're so smart. They're so smart. They are Chinese ethnic Vietnamese, right? You know how we're Chinese ethnic Vietnamese. We're Vietnamese to Vietnamese. Mm-hmm. You know. So, they have their grocery store, which is mammoth. You can find anything there. Then, down here, they have their wholesale store, right? That all of the international food people, the restaurants, go to get their stuff. Ethiopians, Nigerians, Guatemalans, I don't care. I mean, you go in there, and there's a lot of tubby little women. You cannot understand a word they're saying, and they're wearing weird stuff, you know? Okay, but they got their wholesale place, their retail place, then they got their restaurants. So this is how it works. This is how smart it is. You buy the wholesale. They have a refrigeration unit, just refrigeration, bigger than my house. There, half of it, actually. There's a refrigeration unit as big as my house and another freezer unit as big as my house in this wholesale place, right? It is freaky. All right, so they buy wholesale and then give it to their grocery store, which sells retail. Then the stuff that goes kind of out of date goes to the restaurant so they can sell it right away, right? Cook it right away. Brilliant. I don't know if you're a merchant mind or not. I was brought up as a merchant. I see that, I think Einstein. So anyway, they have opened another Viet Hoa on 1960, just as big. Why? Because there's so many straggling Asian operations out there that are restaurants and food stores, and they're serving those Asians and those restaurants. Yesterday I went to go to Sun's, the wholesale place, to buy some stuff, and I just thought, here's the other deal. They started a cash only little restaurant with their family's recipes for soup, for pho, right? For breakfast. It's cash only. That's where they go have lunch. They don't care if anybody else goes there. People go there, but their whole family goes there. They eat their pho or whatever they're going to eat, and they go back to work. It's perfect. And it's their mama's recipes, right? So it works. I went in yesterday, and the papa was there who started the whole thing. I call him Baba. He's 90, and I, you know, he loves to see me because I make a big deal of her, and he likes my cake. He goes, we cannot understand each other at all, and I'm always having somebody translate, but, you know, I just get there to go say hi to him and his wife, and, you know, make nice with old people, right, to make them feel big face. You know, big and strong. It's the same story. That's the same story. It comes out to a very big ending, but it's the same story as my dad, your dad's, who came here to try to build something, so his children will have a better life. Right? It's all our story. So I make a cold call to Vican. I didn't know who the hell he was. I said, I want to meet you. So I met him at Kim San downtown. And I proposed to him. He didn't know who the hell I was. We talked grocery store for a little while. So he could see I was a grocery store girl, right? He's born in the year of the rabbit, I think, or the pig. One of the two, they like nice things, you know? They like stuff to be nice and comfortable. And so I talked him into letting me do a New Year event at Viet Hoa. That was in the year of the rat. It's the first year. It's the first year of the cycle, the Chinese cycle. The rat is the first animal. You know the story about the rat being the first animal? Because he tricked the, I don't know, some animal's gonna take him across the river to the Buddha. The ox. Tricked me, the ox, you know, my companion animal, to get him to Buddha first. So he was the first animal, the rat. So it turns out the first year we're at Viet Hoa is the year of the rat. And we had, I only had 6 weeks to put it together. And I didn't know anything about lion dance. I really was stupid, okay? I didn't know the firecrackers had to be red, okay? I mean, who tells you that kind of stuff, right? Duh. Or that you have to have firecrackers, or it's not New Year's. So here's the other thing. Firecrackers are illegal. So I have to get over this issue of how to manipulate my city contacts to make this work. So we had 6 weeks to do the first one. No money. Did a 1-day deal, short program. Basically, without any advertisement, 10,000 people showed up. So we went, this means something.
How did that happen?
Duh! Word of mouth. I mean, we don't do advertising now. And we have 60,000 people show up. Right? I mean, advertising is way overrated. Word of mouth for this kind of event. Because this is the kind of event that has historical value and resonance for all the Chinese, all the Vietnamese. Because it's at a place, it's a kind of Vietnamese place, you know, that the Vietnamese, and of course the Vietnamese are the largest population, you know, they're the bulk of our audience. But as soon as I saw that we had 10,000 people show up with no advertising, I thought, okay, this is where we need to be. And I started, at the same time, the only other place that was doing real lion dance with firecrackers was Tan Tan. Tan Tan restaurant. And I was friends with Janet Chu, who's the daughter who runs the restaurants, and it was her dad. He's very superstitious. He would take 10% of what they made all year. You know, if they made $800,000, he put $80,000 into lion dance. I mean, he was crazy. You know, and Janet was going, oh man, why is he putting it? And so she tried to keep it up, but she couldn't keep it up because it's just, they had a teeny parking lot. She was having so much trouble with the fire department, with the firecrackers, and controlling their lion dancers not to do stuff that was going to cause them to be citated, you know, for what they're doing. So anyway, I said, okay, I'm going to try to preserve this art form in a place where it's safer and where more people can see it. And that's how we started at Viet Hoa. So we've been there now 10 years. And we've become part of the fixtures. We have, this last year we had event on 2 days. It was Super Bowl weekend. Super Bowl in Houston. Don't ever do that again. We had 12 lion dances. We had firecrackers all over the place. And I think we had about 50,000 people show up over those 2 days. Now, the inside story, when we first started this, about the firecrackers. You know, firecrackers have been banned for New Year celebration in Beijing and Shanghai and Hunan, Taipei, Singapore, Hong Kong, because of two reasons, the air pollution and the fact that their parades were getting too rowdy, all right? That their martial arts groups would like get into conflagrations with each other, and they became violent, and pedestrians got, yeah. So basically the Chinese said, forget that, no more firecrackers. So then in California, no firecrackers. New York, no firecrackers. Houston's the only place we still have firecracker, right? So, the first year we did this, well, actually, it was the second year we did it, because nobody knew what we were doing the first year. You know, it was kind of quiet. The second year, you know, we really built it up, and we had Steve Raddick, who is Commissioner Steve Raddick for the Southwest, was our Grand Marshal, like the first firecrackers. Another funny story, he was always anti-firecracker, all right? He is a hard-nosed Republican, no two firecrackers. And he didn't really understand that when he was up in front of 5,000 people and I was going to let him light the first firecrackers, then all of a sudden he's a fan of firecrackers for our event, you know. But the thing that was weird is that the city of Houston sent a fire marshal out that didn't, he was African American, he was a kind of a small guy, and there's, you know, there's stuff that goes around with, you know, small guy issues, but he comes around, and for firecrackers, you have to have a pyrotechnic who's a licensed firecracker guy. He's got to be paid and on site. You got to have fire marshals paid and on site. You got to have fireworks insurance. All paid for, all expensive, all set. So this guy from the fire marshal's office comes up and starts complaining to my pyrotechnic. Pyrotechnic calls me and says, this guy wants to shut us down. And I say, for why? And he goes, because he's an asshole. And I go, okay. So I go grab Steve Raddick. Okay, Steve Raddick is about 8 feet tall. Okay? I mean, he is a tall guy. I'm short. You know, I'm 5'4". I said, Commissioner, there's a city person. This is where you play the county off the city. Because they hate each other, right? Okay. I need you to come and just listen, to witness what's going to happen with this guy. Because I knew that this fire marshal guy was not going to take well to some loudmouth colored girl, especially Asian, mouthing off to him. So I got my crew behind me too. And I go up to the guy, I said, you know, what's the problem? He goes, well, you're not following regulations. I said, show me in the regulations where we're not following regulations. He goes, I don't have to. And I said, oh, yes, you do. Because I read the regulations. And what you're saying is not in the regulations. He says, well, I can make the regulations here. I said, no, you cannot do that. You're on my dime, and we're going by what the law says. And you cannot do that. He says, I have the right and authority to make decisions on site. And I said, call your supervisor. And I look at Raddick, he goes, right on. So this little skinny black guy calls up his supervisor, who turns out to be a kind of chubby Mexican guy, right? And he's backing up the little black guy. And the guy is saying, well, maybe we can't shut you down this time, but we'll sure make sure you don't get a permit next year. And I said, is that a threat? Did y'all hear this? Did everybody hear this? I think you just made a threat. These guys did not know what to do with me. The show went on. After the show, I mean, Al Huang was a council member, and I called him up on a Saturday going, your people, yeah. So he was freaked out because it was his first year, I think, there, and he wanted to make sure, you know, not to mess with our people. So then, after it's all over, I file formal complaints with the Inspector General's Office of the Fire Department on both these guys and have them dragged in. Right? The next year, our Grand Marshal to light the first firecrackers was the Fire Chief. Ta-da! Yeah, so, but see, that's the thing, is that you're not going to find somebody like me in New York or California. I doubt it. Because everybody in New York, California is going to be taking care of their own tribe. Hmm. Right? They're not going to go out and limb for Vietnamese if you're Chinese. Why? Koreans are not going to go out and limb for Chinese. Why? Yeah. Right?
Because they already have their own little segregated.
That's right. And they don't see it as an amorphous sociological, anthropological lab experiment. Okay. So that's the story of the Asian festival and Lunar New Year. Okay?
See you later. Okay, here you go.
The reason why we have to do all of the archives in a kind of compartmentalized way is that my work and life has been in pods. And sometimes those little pods interconnect, but in large part, they have been separate battles, separate issues. They overlap in a lot of ways. But there's nobody that I know who's had as many lives as me in one life. I start out as a kid in theater. At 8 years old, I'm a professional actor doing The Key and I and South Pacific and Stop the World, I Want to Get Off. I mean, I am in professional theater until I'm 15. At the same time, I am working in a grocery store since I was 8 and learning how to cut meat and getting hijacked and guns put up to my head. At the same time, I am involved with civil rights and working that direction, anti-war movement, women's rights. At the same time, I'm starting a construction firm. I'm the first woman to start a construction firm in the state of Texas. All right? So these are all things going on at the same time. And the only way I decided that I can talk about them and share them is just take them one pod at a time. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Because it's just, most people have not had, I mean, you don't even know about my horse riding career, wrangling horses and racing horses.
I mean, had no idea about the drama.
Well, duh. I mean, the Court Club, that's the first dinner theater I worked in.
Oh.
I got paid like $120 a month at 8 years old. Weird, right? I'm 8 years old. That was 1960. That's before your parents were born. Oh, man. So it's better just peace. I piece the patchwork quilt.
Mm-hmm. Okay, turn it off.